know the joy of the Lord is my strength.
Yes, amen.
I'm going to say the Bible says that the redeemer of the Lord says something. If the joy of the Lord is your strength, God wants you to hear you say it.
Tree. Lifestyle, God, that brings glory to you because of the love, God, because that perfect love casts out all fear, God. Father, there is no fear in love, Father. Father, we come against the spirit of fear, Father. You said that you will have no pleasure in a soul that draws back. Father, thank you for the spirit of boldness, God. For boldness, God, to declare, boldness to live, boldness, God, to open our voice and lift our hands to you and talk about how great you love us. This loving God, this loving God. Father, you loved us, Father, even while we were yet sinners. You loved us, God. Father, when we were in our own way, God, one day you came to each and every one of us, God, and you arrested our agenda, God. Why? Because you love us, God. You love us. You set us straight, God. You set us on the path of life. Father, for thou wilt show us the path of life in thy presence, which fullness of glory. At thy right hand, there are pleasures of glory. Father, we thank you, Lord God, for life, for abundant life, God, all because you love us, God. All because you love us, God. Love of God that loves us so much, God. We thank you, Lord God. It's not because it's in us, in ourselves, but because you first loved us, God, and you put your love within us, God. And we're motivated. That love of God is shed abroad by your spirit in our hearts, God. Father, even when we don't know how to love someone else, Father, you put within us the ability, God. You give us the desire to love those who are unlovely, God. You give us the desire to go after those who are lost, Father. Father, you put within us, Father. We thank you for making Northside a place of love, Father. A fountain of love, Father, that flows, God, through these streets and through this neighborhood, through this nation, God. A fountain, God. Father, we thank you, our God. For, Father, that love, God, from nails will draw. You said if I be lifted up, if love is lifted up, you will draw me. Father, we thank you, our God, for love. Father, radiating from each and every one of our lives here tonight.
Thank you for your love, God. Thank you for your love, God. Your love.
but it's something about worship.
Yes.
God said, I just wanted to. Yeah. Well, we're just excited to be here tonight. I won't be before you long. What I'm going to do is I'm going to start something and then I'll finish it on Wednesday night. So you can say, well, Kelvin, since you're going to finish it Wednesday night, you can keep it short. So I'm going to do that. Hopefully, I don't know, Pastor Steele, but is there maybe Wednesday night, is there a board to write on or something? I know, I think. Maybe Wednesday night we can bring it, because I got a lot of points here, and I like to, you know, write it down and make sure everybody can, as I move forward, it gives you time to capture. But I'll start tonight, and then what I'll do is I'll do a recap on Wednesday night, and then move forward from there. But I don't have to have it tonight. Tonight I'll just talk to you all. How's that? Is that okay?
It's all right.
It's all right. Okay, I got to give you a story, a little bit about my son, a little bit about my daughter, something he did, and that's kind of the theme of my message tonight. I think we could always use our kids for examples. My son, Josh, he was about 11 or 12 when you started. He decided that he wanted to start a little business and start cutting yards, and he got on the computer, and my wife helped him wherever he needed help. But he got on the computer, made himself some flyers, put together his little business cards, and went around the neighborhood and knocking on doors and basically asked for the business. Said, I cut yards. Would you like your yard cut? And so I was kind of shocked. I was a little leery at first, because I'm going, you sure you know how to cut a yard? I mean, I showed him a few times at home, but, I didn't know he was, as a parent, right, I didn't know he was ready. But he was ready. He went out there, and a lot of stuff he does now, landscaping and doing the yards and shrubs and mulching, I mean, he learned all that stuff doing it. But he wasn't afraid to ask. And then my daughter did something. We were visiting a church. It was predominantly a pretty large church, and I guess, half and half, a lot of mixture of different races in the church, and the pastor, he's a Caucasian pastor, but one day, my daughter, this was probably about a couple years ago, after service was over, she took it upon herself to go to the pastor and his wife, and invite him to our house for dinner.
You didn't know it?
We didn't know it. Wait, you did what? I asked him to come over to our house for come over for dinner. Mom, Dad, you always say, we need fellowship, whatever, just went and asked the pastor and his wife to go over for dinner. We said, wait, you can't do that. But my daughter's not afraid to ask. And the title of my message is Don't Be Afraid to Ask. Don't be afraid to ask. And, the Bible says out of the mouth of babes, we learn a lot of things from our kids. And if everyone could turn with me to Psalms 2:8, I'm going to give you three scriptures right up front. Psalms 2:8, John 16, and 1 Kings 3 and 5. So we're going to start with Psalms 2:8. Psalms 2:8. And Psalms 2:8 speaks of, it says, ask of me, and I shall give thee the heathen for thine inheritance, and the uttermost parts of the earth for thy possession. And here, ask of me is... this actually verse was prophetically speaking of Christ being the mediator, that God is actually asking Jesus, telling him, ask of me, and I'll give you the heathen for thine inheritance.
the uttermost parts of the earth, for thy possession. And so it was speaking of Jesus' mediator office. Sounds like a man. And God is basically telling Jesus, you ask of me, and I'll give you. And we know that's because of Christ, right? That we all are coming back into the family of God, right? And then in John 16, 20, 30, you know, we turn there, John 16, 20, 30. John 16, 23, and verse 24 says, in that day, you shall ask me nothing. Verily, verily, I say unto you, whatsoever you shall ask the Father in my name, he will give it. Hitherto have you asked nothing in my name. Ask, and you shall receive, that your joy may be full. So Psalms 2:8, God is telling Jesus to ask, and I'll give it to you. And here, Jesus is telling us to ask, and I'll give it to you. So what we need to realize is, don't be afraid to ask. Okay? So let's talk about the definition of asking. That's where we go to 1 Kings 3 and 5. So let's everybody turn to 1 Kings 3. Here the story, the backdrop to the story is Solomon. 1 Kings 3 and 5. Okay. Here, the backdrop is that Solomon, God is coming to Solomon, which is David's son. Solomon has become king in David's place. And in a dream, God goes to Solomon, and he says to him, and the Lord appeared unto Solomon, 1 Kings 3 and 5, in a dream that night, and God said, ask what I shall give you. In other words, ask me, what is it that you want? Okay? And of course, Solomon said, you know what? I just want you to help me to be able to judge and discern, judge the people. Okay, and God said, well, because you didn't ask him for riches and ask him for the life of your enemies, you didn't ask for this, ask for that, I'm going to give that to you. But along with that, I'm going to give you more than what you asked. Mm-hmm. So there God appears to Solomon and says, ask. So what is the definition of asking? Okay, if I had a board, I'd write it. I had to leave mine at home. To ask. To ask means to inquire. So in other words, God, should I? Okay. Another definition of asking is to request, which means God, can I? Okay. And then the third definition of asking is to demand. God, you got to do this. Have you ever placed a demand on God? God, you got to have this. This has to happen. So it means to place a demand. So let's look at some scripture examples. 2 Samuel 2:1. We're going to look at a lot of scripture. 2 Samuel 2:1. This is the story, the backdrop to the story is that David, Saul was the first king of Israel, right? Now Saul has died, and now it's time for David to step on the scene and be the second king of Israel. So here David is inquiring of the Lord. He said, and it came to pass, 1 Samuel 2:1, and it came to pass that David inquired of the Lord, saying, shall I go up to the cities? Shall I go up into any of the cities of Judah? And the Lord said unto him, go up. And David said, whither shall I go up? And the Lord said unto him, Hebron. So David asked the God, should I go ahead and go into the city? Mm-hmm. And God responded to him. David also asked him, which way should I go? Okay? And God gave him direction. So, and to request, a good example is, and we won't turn there, please mark, write it down, Mark 1:40. Where the leper went to Jesus and said, can I be cleansed? Can I be cleansed? So he's asking God, okay? And then the third example is Luke 18:1. Let's everybody turn there. It's to place a demand on God. Luke 18:1. And in Luke 18:1, Jesus has given us an example. He tells a story about the unjust judge. Okay? And starting at Luke 18:1, it says, "And he spoke a parable unto them to this end, that men ought to always pray and not faint." It said that we should always what?
Pray.
And not faint. And not faint. What does it mean to faint? To quit? To give up?
Yes.
To just throw in the towel?
Yes.
But does God say throw in the towel?
No.
Does he say quit and give up?
No.
What did he say? Always what?
Pray.
Always pray. Y'all, I can tell you, there's been some strange opposition that I've encountered. My family has encountered. Things that I never dreamed that we would go through. But one of the things I learned is don't stop praying.
Yes.
Don't stop praying. No matter how difficult it gets, no matter how wild and crazy and out of this world it may appear to you, don't stop praying. Okay. So as we're looking, continue looking at the definition of asking, which means to demand, here's an example. It says in verse 2, saying that there was in a city a judge, a judge which feared not God, neither regarded men. But there was a widow in that city. She came to him saying, "Avenge me of mine adversary."
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Another translation says, "I need you to give me some legal protection, judge."
Mm-hmm.
And the Bible talks about, now, is she asking him? No. She said, "Avenge me."
Mm-hmm.
She's placing a demand on the judge. Now, we're going to leave it at that because we're going to talk about that more Wednesday night. Okay, this particular passage. But again, to ask God is to inquire.
Mm-hmm.
God, should I? It's a request. God, can I?
Mm-hmm.
And it's the demand. God, you got to do this thing. Okay. Now turn with me Psalms 145:15. Psalms 145:15. So we talked about the definition of asking. And I got my watch right here, y'all, just so you know. We talked about the definition of asking. Now we're going to talk about three elements of asking. Okay? There are three elements of asking. Okay? Just making sure I got all those notes here. Three elements of asking. Okay, one of the ingredients of asking is what asking in itself. I gave you the definition, but within that definition, there are three elements about asking. Okay. Number one is the posture. Everybody right posture. Okay. It's the posture when you ask. Secondly, it's the desire when you ask.
Hmm.
And thirdly, it's the request itself. It's what you're asking for. Okay. So we're going to talk about that a little bit, and then we'll move on to the other pieces of asking. So first of all, it's the posture. So when we turn to Psalms 145:15, it says, "The eyes of the Lord, the eyes of all wait upon thee, and thou givest them their meat in due season. Thou openest thy hand and satisfies the desire of every living thing." Okay. Here, we're going to see these three ingredients in this verse. It's the posture, it's the request, it's the desire, and then it's the request itself. Okay, first of all, the posture. If you notice in the scripture, it says, "The eyes of all wait upon thee." Okay, so what is that saying? That verse is acknowledging that God is greater.
Yes.
And it's acknowledging that God has all the resources.
Yes.
Because it says, "The eyes of all are waiting on you."
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so when you're asking God, remember the posture. How are we being humble about our request? When we pray, when we're asking God, are we acknowledging within our heart that God has got the resources?
Yes.
He can answer this request.
Yes.
I know my son often comes to me, my 11-year-old, which is about tall as me, by the way. He constantly comes to me, "Dad, can I have my allowance?" "No, not right now. Later, Dad, can I have my allowance?"
No. Did you clean your room? Go clean his room. Come back. Dad, can I have my allowance? You know, why is he coming to me?
Because he knows you have what he needs.
Because he knows, you know, at least he thinks I have it, right?
And obviously you're promising.
And I promised him. But he's acknowledging that I have the resources and that I have a greater position, right? Because he's willing to come to me and ask.
Yes.
So when we go to God, we have to recognize who we're going to.
Yes, amen.
You know, you're not just saying a prayer in vain. I'm just saying some words because that's what the way we're supposed to do it.
Right.
But when you go to God, you're going to him knowing, God, I already know right now you have the ability to meet this request.
Yeah. Amen. Amen.
You have the ability.
Yes.
Right? God, I know you can do it.
Yes.
Okay? So it's the posture. Okay? So we're acknowledging that he's greater, and we're acknowledging that he has the resources to do it. Okay? All right? As that scripture also says, all the eyes wait on thee, the eyes of all wait on thee, and thou givest their meat in due season. So now is the request. Okay, it's the request itself. Alright? The request itself, he says he gives them their meat in due season. So that meat represents the need, the request. It's the request itself. God, I need some meat. My eyes are waiting on you. My son, Dad, I'm waiting on you to give me my allowance. Okay, so it's the request itself. Their request, this verse is implying that we're requesting our food in the season that we're supposed to get it in.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so it's the posture, it's the request itself.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and the Bible says in Ephesians 3:20, now God is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we could think or even ask.
Yeah.
So not only does God have the resources, but when you do ask him for it, not only is he able to give you what you ask for, but he's able to do what? Much more.
Yes.
Just like he did Solomon. He said, because you only asked me this, I'm going to give you all of this along with it.
Amen.
So that's expectingly.
Praise God.
How many when you pray, you're expecting God to do it?
Yes.
Amen.
You're not just saying words.
That's right.
You know, you're not just saying words.
Amen.
You're crying out to God.
Amen.
Don't you expect him to hear your cry?
Amen.
You're placing a demand on God. Aren't you expecting God to hear you?
Yes.
The Bible says his ears are open to the cry of the righteous. Okay?
Amen.
So there's the posture, there's the request. And you know, we need something. There's something that only God can do. You know? And there's a need in our hearts that only God can satisfy. And so when you go to God, remember, he has the resources. He wants to meet the request because he's going to do more than what you ask for. And then there's the desire. And the desire is, do you really want it? Do you really want it? John 14:14 says, if you ask anything in my name, I will do it. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Let's turn to John 14:14, because I don't think that's correct. 14:14. Yep, that is correct. And the Bible says also in another scripture, whatsoever you desire when you pray.
Yes.
Okay, let's back up a second. Whatsoever you desire, what does that desire mean? It means to beg for it. It means to crave it. It means to desire so much. And Miles Monroe one time said in his book, you want it so bad that you're willing to sacrifice anything for it. That's having a true desire. See, we can say all day, and I know I did this for many years. I eventually went back to school. But for several years prior to that, I kept saying, one day I'm going to go back to school. Year go by, I'm going to go back to school. 3 years go by, I'm going to go back to school. God, help me go back to school. Help me, Father, if you can help meet the need for me to go back to school. But you know what? I didn't desire it. Because when you desire it, there's a craving. There is something that you can't sleep at night. I mean, you got to have that thing. You think about it.
Yes.
It's on your mind.
Yes.
It's a vision in your heart.
Yes.
I mean, you walk down the street thinking about that thing. When somebody talks to you, that's coming, it's rolling off your lips. Why? Because it's an intense desire. And the Bible says when you have that intense desire, when you pray, then believe that God's going to give it to you.
Amen.
Then you will have it.
Amen. Praise God.
Sometimes we don't desire it enough.
That's right.
I didn't desire to go to school enough. one day I finally walked into some place. It was some, I don't know what it was. Where you go in at night and they tell you about the school and all this kind of stuff. I let somebody talk me into going. And I went with them that night, and then they would tell you all about the school. And finally, and I said, I'm going to go back to school. And finally, the lady looked at me and said, well, here you go. Sign up. So, no, I'm not ready to sign up. She said, what are you waiting on? She said, if you don't sign up, you'll never sign up. And I finally went, she said, just sign up, go to the first class. If you don't want to do it, then just drop it. And it's, you lost nothing but, you know, a night. So I went ahead and signed up. Sure enough, now all of a sudden I got a schedule. All of a sudden I got to be somewhere. And then once I went, I kept going. And finally the desire became a true desire, right? Not just words, right? Okay, so it's the desire. So the three elements of asking is the posture, the desire, and the request. Okay? Now, the second element of asking is there are seasons of asking. Okay? There are seasons to asking. Okay? And as part of seasons to asking, there are three key things. It's knowing when to ask, it's knowing what to ask, and it's knowing how to ask. Okay? So we're going to talk about when to ask and what to ask. And I believe, depending on how much time we got left, then we'll pick up Wednesday night. So the second element of asking is the seasons of asking. Okay, so the first piece to the seasons of asking is when to ask. When should I ask God? Okay? A good example is when you're about to embark upon something new. Okay? When you're about to embark upon something new. Maybe new relationships. Maybe a new commitment to something. Okay? Like I said, my example of going back to school, I was getting ready to make a commitment. You know, God, is this the right time? Is this the right time? Should I do this? Okay. So that's just an example. A good example of when to ask is when you need direction. Okay? You need direction in your life. That's a good time to ask. Another time it's good to ask, when to ask, is in the midst of struggle. Okay? When you're in the midst of struggle. So let's look at some examples there in the midst of struggle. Jesus in Luke 22, in Luke 22, 39. Luke 22, 39. The story is Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. Okay? And it says, and it came, starting in verse 39, and he came out and went as he was wont to the Mount of Olives, and his disciples also followed him. And when he was in the place, he said unto them, pray that ye enter not into temptation. And he was withdrawn from them about a stone's cast. Excuse me. And he kneeled down and prayed. And he said, Father, if it be your will, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, thy will. Nevertheless, my will, but thy will be done. Okay? So Jesus was struggling at that moment. And what does he do in the midst of his struggling moment? He asked God. He asked God. So a good time when to ask is when you're struggling. Another example is Joshua 7. Let's everybody turn to Joshua 7. Joshua 7. The whole 7th chapter is talking about after Joshua and the children of Israel just defeated Jericho. Everybody, who doesn't know the story about Jericho? Okay. They just defeated their enemy, Jericho. Jericho that, I mean, it was a fortified, it was a well-fortified place. And yet, Joshua and the children of Israel, just by blowing the trumpet, right, marching around it, following what God told them to do, the walls, they didn't have to take a hammer, right? They didn't take a drill. What did they do? They didn't need a tank, right? All they had to do was obey what God said, march, and blow the trumpet, and the walls came crumbling down. Okay? So they had a great victory. And then in chapter 7, here's these people called Ai. A small little group of people that Joshua said, we don't need to all go after them. I tell you what, let's just take a few men. They took a few thousand men, I believe, and they went after that little group of people called Ai. And what happened was, they got their behinds whipped. And they are running all different directions, running for their life. So Joshua's like, okay, I don't get it. We just defeated Jericho, and these little people over here, we're running from them. He said, God, he went to his knees. He's struggling, y'all. He's struggling. How many of y'all have ever attempted to do something and it just all falls apart? It all falls apart. You had this great plan. You had the strategy. You had everything going that you thought. Everything was in place, and it just don't pan out. And you're like, okay, God, what just happened? All right? That's a good time. That's a win to ask. Okay? So when Joshua did decide to ask God, God told him, and we're going to jump down to verse 6, Joshua 7, verse 6. And Joshua rent his clothes and fell to the earth upon his face and before the ark of the Lord until eventide. And he and the elders of Israel put dust upon their heads. And Joshua, Joshua said, Alas, O Lord, wherefore hast thou at all brought this people over Jordan to deliver us at the hands of the Amorites to destroy us? Would to God we had been content to dwell on the other side of Jordan? So Joshua is going to God and basically saying, what happened? Alright? So then, verse 10, the Lord says, get up. Wherefore liest thou thus upon thy face? Israel has sinned. So Joshua, in the midst of struggle, went to God. And God, he said, God, I don't understand what's going on. Okay? Alright? So now that steps into the phase 2. The seasons of asking, and that's knowing what to ask. Knowing what to ask. So in this case, in the same example with Joshua, Joshua said, something is wrong. Okay? Something is wrong. So he sought God for the answer. Okay? And when he sought God for the answer, and this is a key that we learned from Joshua, he was willing to face the answer, no matter how difficult the answer may have been. Okay? So when you do go to God in the midst of struggle, be willing to accept the answer that he gives you.
That's right. Amen.
Okay? So Joshua, we learned that from Joshua. He sought God for the answers. And what God told him was, get up. I mean, he's crying out. God said, get up. Alright? So what does that tell us? When God gives you the answer, you need to stop what you're doing and go ahead and correct what you need to correct. Okay? Because he's not going to show you just so that you can go, oh, I don't agree with that. Or I don't want to do that. Or no. Right? But if you're willing to hear what he has to say, once he shows you, then what? Now you have to take the action. There's something on your part that you have to do. Okay? Sometimes we don't understand when God is silent. And one of the reasons that God can be silent is because he already gave us the answer, but we're not willing to accept that answer. So we keep going back to God, asking the same question. And we wonder why I'm not getting anything. I'm not hearing anything. I don't know why he's not responding to me. Well, you may have to go back in your journal. You may have to go back into your prayer notes. You might have to go back 6 months ago when God had already spoke to you and you made a note. You know, sometimes I have to go back. And I find out that God had already answered my question before I even went through it, before I even knew to ask, what's going on? Isn't that amazing?
Yes.
Because he already knows. He already knows. Let's look at another example. Let's go back to Jesus in the garden. That was an example of what to ask. Jesus said, God, can you let this thing pass from me? Do I really have to? So Jesus was specific, and God gave him his answer, because Jesus said, nevertheless, it's not my will, but it's your will. God's answer for Jesus was his will. Okay? And Jesus was willing to accept that. Okay? All right? But let's look at another example of struggling. And this is where I'm and this will be my last point that we're going to make tonight. And that would be 1 Samuel 30. Let's go to 1 Samuel 30. 1 Samuel 30. This story is about David, when David and his men have been off to battle. And then they come back home to a place called Ziglag. And they come back home to their place, and they find out when they get home that their place had been burned, their stuff had been taken, and their family had been removed. Okay. So we're going to talk about the story a little bit. Let's read. And it came to pass, starting at verse 1, when David and his men had come to Ziklag on the third day, that the Amalekite had invaded the south in Ziklag and smitten Ziklag and burned it with fire. And it had taken the women captive that were therein. They slew not any, either great or small, but carried them away and went on their way. So David and his men came to the city, and behold, it was burned with fire, and their wives and their sons and their daughters were taken captive. Then David and the people that were with him lifted up their voice and wept until they could weep no more. And David's two wives had been taken captive. And then we're going to jump down to verse 6. And David was greatly distressed, for the people spoke of stoning him, because the soul of all the men was grieved, every man for his sons and his daughters. But David encouraged himself in the Lord his God. And David said to Abiathar the priest, Ahimelech's son, I pray thee, bring me hither the ephod. And Abiathar brought thither the ephod to David. And David inquired the Lord, saying, shall I pursue after this troop? Shall I overtake them? And he answered, pursue, for thou shalt overtake them, and thou shalt recover all. Okay. Here an example of David praying in the midst of a struggle. He's going through several things. Number one, he's heartbroken because his wives are gone. Okay? He's heartbroken because all the wives are gone.
Yes.
The children are gone.
Yes.
Their city is burned.
Yes.
I mean, and I can't even imagine what Pastor Sister Hill went through after they had a fire and coming back to their home and seeing, you know. But that's a semblance of what David and them went through after a great victory they just had.
Yes.
Who knows how long it took? A few days, a few weeks for them to get back home. And imagine them seeing it from a distance. Mm. All they see is black.
Mm.
Imagine. And all the men, they're all excited, and all of a sudden, all of them just standing around, staring downhill into the valley, and they just see black. And they're all going down. And the Bible talks about, so David was greatly distressed. Okay? And I would imagine in David's mind, there probably would be questions. Right?
Yeah.
God gave me this victory right here, and then I get home and I have this great defeat. Have you ever been through something like that? Okay? So, then, not only that is David having to deal with that, but now the men, the Bible says, they all wept until they could weep no more. There was nothing left in them. Have you ever cried yourself to where you just can't, it's just nothing there. Nothing's left. Okay? And then add to that, the men turn around and they turn on David. Okay. So think about that. That would be a very difficult situation. Okay? A very difficult situation. Okay, so what we learn from that is, now David gets ready to inquire of the Lord. So what is he getting ready to do? He's getting ready to ask. Okay? But sometimes we learn two things from it. Sometimes we don't ask the right question. And secondly, we're not in the frame of mind to ask the question. And we're going to see this in this passage. Okay? Sometimes we don't get the answers we need in the midst of situations because we're not asking the right question. Let me give you an example of what I went through. When I was here, right out of college, I was an auditor for 2 years. And while I was an auditor, it was very difficult. It was a very stressful time. I was working, 12-hour, 14-hour days. I'd go off sites. We'd have to go out of town and then just sit, just basically live at these sites and do audits for 2 or 3 weeks at a time, okay, and then come back home. And it was so stressful that finally I said, I don't know what I want. All I know is I want out. All I know is I want out. And I remember being over a friend's house, and there were other friends gathered around. And I remember I was going through a newspaper, and a young lady walked up to me who I didn't know that was at the house. You know, she came to me and she said, "What are you doing?" I said, "I'm looking for a job." She said, "Well, why are you looking for a job?" I said, "Because I got to get out of this auditing business, get away from this company. I don't want to do it anymore." She said, "Well, what is it you want to do?" I said, "I don't know. All I know is I want out." She said, "Well, how can God get you out if you don't tell him what you want?"
That's right.
"Well, where are you going? I mean, what is it you want?" You know? So finally I had to sit back and go, "Okay, what is it I want? I mean, I'm so focused that I just want out, but I don't know where I want to go to." Right? Why go from one fry, how they say,
from the frying pan to the frying pan?
Yeah. You gotta know what is it that we need God to do, right? So I wasn't asking the right question, okay? But secondly, I wasn't in the frame of mind to ask, okay? David, we see here, David wasn't in the frame of mind. So what did David do? Okay, we learned from David, okay? Let's go there. Let's go back to verse 6 says, "And David was greatly distressed, for the people spoke of stoning him, because the soul of all people were grieved, every man for his sons and daughters." And what is the first thing that David does? Inquire of God?
He encouraged himself in the Lord first.
Sometimes we're not in the frame of mind to ask God questions. Why? Because too many times we make decisions out of stress,
mm-hmm.
out of anger, mm-hmm. out of being afraid, mm-hmm. okay?
Mm-hmm. Feelings and emotions.
Feelings and emotions? Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, I prayed about it. I'm getting out of here. I prayed about it, all right. What's really driving that decision? He hit it, the emotions.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Sometimes, how many of y'all know, how many we all can admit, sometimes we say things out of anger or out of emotion, that where had we been in the right frame of mind, we wouldn't have said
that's
it.
Right. Amen.
Or we may not have said it that way.
Amen.
Right? Right. So David is teaching us, no, don't go ask God yet. Why is stress? Don't go ask God yet.
Yes.
Why? Because our emotions might take the voice of God. Our hurt may take the voice of God, right? We think we know this is what God is saying. I know God is saying this, right? But what David teaches us, he encouraged himself in the Lord.
Yes.
By him encouraging himself in the Lord, he got himself out of that emotional trauma state and got into a worship, got into a thankful. God, he started seeing God as bigger than anything he could ever go through, right? He forgot about the men ready to stone him, and he started focusing on the rock, right? The rock of Jesus. He started focusing on God is greater than what just happened to us, right? So now the Bible says David is now encouraged. Okay, now he's now on God's level now. Now he got a connection with God. Because now it's not the mindset, the mind that's talking, but now he's getting ready to get something in the spirit, right? So David says, "Bring me the ephod," and that's what they used to use to inquire of God. And now David's ready to inquire. He says, "God, should I go?" Now, had he been in the attitude state, he would have said, "Oh yeah, I'm going. Y'all stay here. I do it by myself." Right? You think it would have got him anywhere?
No.
You think he would ever even found his family, right? But no, he got God's mind about it. But before he got God's mind, he had to be in the right state of mind. Okay?
Amen.
In the right state of mind. When our outlook changes, then we're in the position to ask God. Okay? Sometimes God used difficulty to get us to start asking. Okay? To get us to start asking. Alright? So, you have to be in the right frame of mind to ask. Okay? So, based on that, I think, well, I'm just going to stop right here. Okay, so the seasons of asking is when to ask, is what to ask, and Wednesday night we'll pick up on how to ask. And then there's one more element of asking that we'll cover as well. So, let's, I just want to go ahead and close the prayer, well, at least close this piece of it in prayer. Father God, in Jesus' name, we thank you for your word. We thank you for how you are breaking bread before us, God, in Jesus' name. You're teaching us, God. Father, it's not easy. Father, I know even me and my family, God, there has been some great battles, God. And Father, I've been inquiring of you and inquiring of you. God, you got to show me. God, you got to help me. You got to give me the answer, God. Father, there were some times where I was so emotionally distraught, God, that I couldn't even get words out. I couldn't even pray, Father. But Father, putting on some worship music or doing whatever it takes just to get my spirit in the right frame of mind, God. Father, I thank you that, Lord God, when worship takes place, God, Father, you're ready to show us your will. You're ready to reveal the enemy, God. Father, you're ready to unfold tomorrow and your purpose for our lives, Father. Father, you're ready to restore. Father, you're ready to take back what the enemy has stolen, Father. But we have to be in the right frame of mind when we go to God. And being willing to accept the answer that you give us, God.
Yes.
And not only accept the answer, but to take action, God, on the answer, God. We thank you, Lord God. We will not be afraid to ask. We will not be afraid to ask.
Yes.
And we give you all the glory and honor and praise. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
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 Glory to God.
Amen.
Yeah, let's go, brother.
Amen. Amen.